Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us, I hope, again. I don't want to get ahead of myself too quickly, but I did want to address something. Tomorrow, the Vice President of the United States, Mike Pence, will be in Indiana. He'll be up in Kokomo, Indiana, at the General Motors plant, who are turning out ventilators. Very proud of that fact. And I will join him. And due to the modern marvels of technology, I'll be able to be in two places almost at the same time. And so I will be here tomorrow, maybe not sitting right here, but I will join the Lieutenant Governor tomorrow, Thursday, Dr. Box, Commissioner Fred Payne from our Department of Workforce Development. I'll join you all tomorrow at 2:30 as well. And just like yesterday, we've got another very important substantive day today. We've made some more progress. We talked about testing yesterday, Dr. Lindsey Weaver, in your place. It's good to have you back in the 2:30 saddle again, but Dr. Weaver was able to roll out our testing project, and today we're going to talk about a kind of a complement to that effort, and that's tracing. And so with that, if you could give us kind of the latest on the ground numbers and then talk about that in-depth tracing project that we got going.
Sure. Thank you, Governor. Welcome, Hoosiers. I'm sorry I missed the last couple of days for the press conference. Unfortunately, my father's been very ill, and in my hometown of Terre Haute, Indiana, he's been receiving excellent care there and is stable at this point in time. So I continue to appreciate your prayers and your support in the coming days. Today, from a daily update standpoint, we have had 605 new confirmed cases in the state of Indiana. Unfortunately, added 63 additional deaths here in the state of Indiana. We did add an additional 4,503 new tests here in the past 24 hours. I want to shout out a big thank you to Kroger, which has just announced that it will be launching free drive-through testing starting tomorrow in Fort Wayne and is working to add an additional site here in Marion County. I also want to share some exciting news about our personal protective equipment. As you know, N95 respirators in particular have been in very short supply, and I have shared stories of our emergency room physicians, many of whom you have seen here with the governor on our daily presser. But those physicians have been using that same mask for a number of weeks at a time. I'm thrilled to announce that Indiana has acquired what's called a Battelle Critical Care Decontamination System that will allow our hospitals, our EMS, our dentists, and other healthcare providers to conserve their N95s by sending them to a central location to be decontaminated. Providers will be able to sign up to get a unique code for their facility and then collect the N95s that need to be cleaned and ship them to a designated site. Each N95 can then be cleaned up to 20 times, which will vastly extend the protection we provide to our frontline workers. We're sending information to our healthcare systems today and hope to be able to start this cleaning process late next week. Yesterday, I know that Dr. Weaver shared with you our plan for expanding testing in the state of Indiana starting next week with Optum in 20 fixed sites, and we will be expanding that to 50 total sites across the state of Indiana. ISDH will then be able to continue to assist with testing in our congregate settings with our high-risk individuals, like in long-term care facilities, prisons, jails, factories, and plants. Also, we can focus on making sure that each of our populations that experience difficulty in getting tested and or achieving health care and connecting to health care for COVID-19 is able to do that. Today, I want to share with you how ISDH plans to support and augment the work of our local health departments that our local health departments have already been doing for case investigation and contact tracing for each COVID-19 patient. When we identify an individual who is positive for COVID-19, we need to determine who they have been in contact with and then individually notify each of those contacts. This is important so that we can minimize the spread of COVID-19. Historically, our local health departments across the state have done the majority of the case investigations for COVID-19. The local health departments receive the positive cases every day through our data system at the Indiana State Department of Health. They then reach out to each positive person and do something called a case investigation, which normally is a phone interview, which takes 1 to 2 hours. We also must educate the individual that they need to isolate for a minimum of 7 to 10 days and what signs or symptoms to look for that might trigger the need for them to access additional health care and how they should access that health care. During this time, we will also ask questions about who the individual has been in close contact with, whether that was at work, at home, or in a social setting, and get the addresses or phone numbers that we can reach out to these individuals. Each case often will have around 10 additional contacts that need to be contacted so that we can let them know they need to quarantine for 14 days. And if they get symptoms, then we must get them tested to follow them up as a positive case. Also, if they do not develop symptoms after 14 days, they can come out of quarantine. With this pandemic, the Indiana State Department of Health has taken over the contact tracing for 16 local health departments across the state and has assisted with many other local health departments because of the sheer number of cases, especially related to outbreaks in our large plants or factories. An important requirement for us being able to open back up in our state is that we must be able to test individuals quickly and isolate them if they are positive, and then contact individuals who have been in close contact with them and let them know that they must quarantine themselves for 14 days. This is the way we can stop the spread. The process of calling a positive patient and identifying all of their contacts, as you can imagine, is extremely time-consuming, and many times people do not answer their phone if they don't recognize the number calling them. I know I wouldn't. This is why the Indiana State Department of Health plans to use technology to reach out to all COVID-positive patients with an email and a text and ask them to call our call center. The call center will be operating 12 hours a day, 7 days per week. When the individual calls in, our centralized call center, which Maximus will be staffing for us, will complete the initial phone interview, identify the contacts that need to be notified, and then send a text or an email to each of those contacts. If the COVID-positive individual does not call within 4 hours, we will begin to call the patient. This centralized technology-based system will free our local health departments up to focus on connecting individuals in isolation or quarantine to local resources that they may need in order to support themselves. It will also allow our local health departments to assist with education, with further testing and cohorting in our high-risk congregate settings, and allow them to assist with follow-up and connection to individuals that are more difficult to reach. We're still finalizing the details of the contract, but we expect this cost to run about $43 million per year, and the call center and technology platform are both included in this cost. This is what we will use to contact positive patients and their contacts, and we expect this plan to go live on May 11th. Our local health department engagement in this effort remains absolutely critical. To provide supportive services such as food and housing for COVID patients, and to help support those congregate settings with reaching people in a local level if they can't be reached through centralized contact tracing. My hope is that this will allow our local health departments to use their highly educated staff to not only focus on these priorities, but also ensure that the essential public health functions such as immunizations, which will continue to need to be done, will not be a strain on their resources. It's now my pleasure, Governor, to introduce Dr. Mark Fox. He is the Deputy Health Officer for St. Joseph's County. He's gonna talk with us today, hi Mark, about contact tracing and what that's looked like at the local health department level. And as we add these additional resources, how those might change. How have you been?
I'm well, Chris. Thanks very much for the opportunity to be with you and Governor Holcomb. And best wishes to your dad for continued health.
Thank you, Mark. That's very kind of you. I appreciate that. So can you talk to us a little bit about contact tracing? A lot of the state of Indiana may not know that you do this on a regular basis, even when there's not a COVID-19 pandemic.
Sure. We have a team of six public health nurses, two of whom really devote their time almost exclusively to TB cases, and others that do, a range of different public health investigations, including childhood lead, but any foodborne illnesses and hepatitis and other things. So they have tremendous experience with contact tracing. With the onset of COVID-19, we've really had to redeploy a substantial part of our workforce in St. Joseph County and devote their attention almost exclusively to contact tracing for COVID-19. So we have the track record of doing it for other conditions, but it, certainly with the volume of cases, we have over 600 cases here in St. Joseph County. And as you pointed out, that initial investigation into the case is a substantial commitment of personal and staff time to conduct a good investigation. I think one of the interesting challenges as we make this transition, the governor actually has made it somewhat easier to do contact tracing with the stay-at-home order, because our hope certainly is that most of our cases have had very little contact out in the community unless they've been engaged in essential work functions. And so as we contemplate reopening the economy and people becoming more broadly engaged in the community, it's essential that we have ready access to testing. So obviously great progress on the horizon in that regard, and the ability to respond, you know, in a timely fashion to positive cases and get any of their contacts into quarantine to reduce the transmission, and yet allowing kind of economic and life to return to as normal as possible. So I think the combination of enhanced access to testing and the contact tracing is really critical to our ability to do that.
Yeah, and I think you make a really good point, is that even though it may be acceptable at this point to be doing all of this as a local health department, and as you mentioned, just like myself at the Indiana State Department of Health, we've pulled resources from all different agencies and from all over our agency to focus just on COVID-19. But eventually we have to get back to that business of childhood immunizations and all of those other things, like investigating restaurants and other things. So that's really important. And when we start to open up, we expect to see more cases, which will bring more contact tracing about, correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So as we talk about this, and we know that it's going to get more difficult, how do you see this allowing you to be able to focus maybe on, you know, you've got six public health nurses, that's absolutely awesome, allowing them to function kind of at the level of their licensure, right, at the highest level of their licensure?
Correct. Well, as you pointed out, first of all, just like everyone else wants to get back to something more closely resembling normal life, we want to get back to normal operational levels in the health department with restaurant inspections and other things. So that's certainly is one part of it. You know, I think the beauty of this solution is combining both the people skills and technology to extend this contact tracing across the state. And you know, as devastating as the health and medical consequences of COVID-19 have been across the state and across the nation, we recognize that the economic and social consequences actually probably even outpace the medical consequences. And so I think one of the really important aspects of this is the ability to identify health-related social needs and address those. You know, as an example, just here locally, in the last few days, we had a family where both adults in the household were tested over the weekend and were positive. Two of their children were positive. And identifying that, the impact for that family, actually one of our health system partners was able to deploy their community health workers and ensure that they had groceries and everything else that they need to, mm-hmm. you know, hopefully weather this storm in their own home. But when no one is able to go out to the grocery store, we need to, you know, meet the needs of those families as well. So, you know, that's just one example, and the ability to identify those needs and respond in real time would be critical.
Yeah, so that connection to resources at the local level is something that you guys do best, something that we know you need to be engaged with. Also, finding that individual that's very hard to contact, right? The one that never answers the phone, their email, or their text, and knowing that you can go to their work and call and find out and maybe even knock on their door is a huge part of this.
Absolutely. You know, even with the improvement in turnaround time on testing results, we're pretty routinely getting them now within 1 to 2 days, which is certainly better than where we were a month ago. But the risk of losing people to follow up even in the course of 1 to 2 days is a challenge, and some are incredibly difficult to reach. So the very personal outreach, and as you said, even being able to go to their home when necessary, mm-hmm. is going to be critical, because our goal is to let people, you know, return to their normal life, but then to be able to react swiftly to ensure that they're in isolation and to identify their close contacts and get them into quarantine. Mm-hmm.
So even those individuals that are in quarantine will get a daily text that will actually query them about their symptoms. And if they should develop symptoms, then that allows you to act on that too.
Absolutely. You know, ongoing symptom monitoring for people who have tested positive to see if there's clinical deterioration is important. And for close contacts who are in quarantine, to be able to react promptly and get them into testing should they develop symptoms is really critical. And that's where the technology piece can be play such an important role for us.
Is there anything else, Dr. Fox, Mark, that I haven't asked you want to make sure that you add?
You know, I think one other piece is I hope in the not too distant future we'll also have good access to rapid test results, just like we do for strep throat and flu. Because as I said, even the 1 to 2 day turnaround time for test results poses some risk of loss to follow-up. But if you can find out while you're still in a provider's care or right at a test site that you're positive and immediately know that you need to go into isolation, just like for flu or strep throat, that will be a great asset to have when that is consistently and reliably available. Obviously, we're not there yet, but certainly rapid testing will be the next piece to add to this complement.
Yeah, and it's just a matter of not being able to have access right now to those cassettes and those machines, but that point of care testing is so critical, even as new factories and businesses open up, right? To be able to test people that are symptomatic right there will be a dramatic improvement.
Yeah, so we're all looking forward to that day.
Yeah. Well, Mark, I just want to thank you, as a representative of all of our local health officers across the state. You and Dr. Einterns have been great partners in this, really have worked with us with regards to surge planning and testing. I always appreciate the advice and the information that I get from you. So thank you for that collaboration and partnership.
I think the collaboration is really critical. This is unlike anything we've faced, and certainly in my professional lifetime. You know, we don't always get it right the first time, and so it's a dynamic thing and a work in progress, so the ability to collaborate is critical. So thank you for the opportunity to be with you today.
Thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you, Dr. Box. Thank you, Dr. Fox, for joining us. That's just another wonderful example of this partnership. You mentioned the local and the state, and by the way, our federal partners who are helping in tremendous ways in terms of funding so that we can carry out these two kind of twin projects of testing and tracing. You also, Dr. Box, talked about our supply chain and decontaminating or cleaning these N95 masks and making sure that folks have masks. And I never lose sight of the fact of the folks, these sewing groups that are continuing to supply our chain and keep that pipeline full and flowing. And you've heard me talk about, in all ages, by the way, and backgrounds, folks who have never sewed a stitch in their life, probably paid a lot of other people to do it for them, myself. There's one example that just really is, I think, beautiful, and it's up in Pulaski County, so not too far away from St. Joe County. And it's they go by Scrappy Sewers. That's their group, Scrappy Sewers. And they've got this beautiful, simple business model where literally, and they've done over 3,000 facial coverings or masks to date. And their model is one lady leaves them out on the front porch, and then you take what you need.
Wow.
And that's
awesome.
It. And if that isn't Hoosier, I don't know what is. So thank you to the Scrappy Sewers up in Pulaski County. You're getting it done. And we and the folks that are protected by your product and your generosity are equally so. Rachel, you want to get us to the Q&A?
Dustin Grove, WTHR.
Hello, Dustin. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Governor. President Trump has ordered the reopening of meat packaging and processing plants. We've had positive cases from some of our facilities here in Indiana. I'm wondering if you agree with that mandate. Do you think it's perhaps premature here in Indiana? And how do you ensure these companies, once they do open, that they're doing everything possible to keep their employees, their communities, and the consumers healthy?
Yeah, it's a partnership. I'll kick it over to you in just a second. But look, I don't want to be a hypocrite. I said a few weeks ago that we needed to make sure that our meat and our medicine supply chains were kept open and flowing. And we need to do everything we can to make sure that that business is safely conducted. And so, of course, I agree with making sure that our that supply chain, that the meatpacking supply chain, and is getting to market. We want to make sure that our groceries are stocked. We want to make sure that you can go and provide for your families. Now, having said that, we'll be there. We've been testing there. We want to make sure the bottom line is, and the president did not contradict any of this, it's done in a safe and timely fashion. That's why we got up there and tested 100% of the folks there. That's why we've been working with the company in Logansport to make sure that those barriers, all the physical distancing, everything that needs to go into that business plan is done, and that it can be up and running. And I don't know if you want to add some specifics about the cases or...
Sure. So I think this is really important. We have been working on it in the state of Indiana and working with companies for several weeks now. But over the weekend, Director Redfield from the CDC directly reached out to me about the importance of this, stating that, you know, sometimes we don't realize when things close here that they were up to almost 25% of pork producing factories were actually closing. So he was stressing the importance. They had just gotten the new guidelines out, and we walked through everything that we were talking about and really doing exactly what they wanted us to do. But of course, we want to continue to protect employees. So if you look at even Tyson, you know, 50% of employees were positive up there, but another 50% were not. And so with the social distancing and the barriers that they've put in and the deep cleaning that they've done and the requirement of masks and the screening of individuals, there's no reason those individuals couldn't come back, even if the plant is functioning at a lower level than what they were before. So our goal is to keep the plants open, but not at the expense of the health of the individuals, the employees that work there.
Yeah, and I would just say, just before this press conference, we had a conference call with Vice President, with Sonny Perdue, the Secretary of Ag, with our Secretary of Ag here in the state of Indiana, Bruce Kettler, right at this very table, and going over, making sure that that supply chain across the country, as you just alluded to and articulated, is up and running safely. And that's the bottom line, safely.
Jordan Burroughs, WLFI.
Hello, Jordan. Good afternoon.
Hello, Governor. Thanks for letting me ask you guys a question here.
Sure.
My question is actually for Dr. Box, a little bit unrelated to the topic here. Sure. My question is actually for Dr. Box, a little bit unrelated to the topic today. I've noticed that with cases, looking at data, that men have seemed to have been dying at about a 10% higher rate than women, whereas the adverse, women have either been tested more or are getting those tests more, around 10% too. What's the correlation between those? Is there something between the difference in genders, men and women, why COVID affects their bodies differently?
Yeah, you know, it's not necessarily that. It's more that women are oftentimes the healthcare leaders in their families. I've been an obstetrician gynecologist for over 30 years now, and women often lead their families into their healthcare. So they pick the pediatricians and the internal medicine docs and the family docs and everyone else. And women tend to come in and do their annual exams. They tend to get their blood pressure under control and to address other health problems. Unfortunately, a lot of our husbands, and I can not say that my husband is one of these, he's very good at this, but they don't always come in and do their annual exams and the care that they need. We do have a higher incidence of men who suffer from higher comorbidities, or those chronic health diseases that can then contribute to an increased mortality rate and morbidity with this.
Yeah, I would say that hit really close to home.
Sorry, sir.
I knew what you were going to say. I will say it at one point in my life, my doctor said he would share my results if my wife was with me, because I would embellish if she was not. So I get it.
John Russell, the Indianapolis Business Journal.
Hello, John. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Governor. Dr. Box, a few weeks ago, you mentioned that you would be trying to raise an army, I think were your words, to build this contact tracing effort. And it sounded as if that army was going to be consisting of college students and retirees in cooperation maybe with some of the public health schools in the state. It sounds like the model that you've rolled out today is different from that. Can you explain how you moved from that point to this point, and how big is the army that you're dealing with now? How many workers will there be? Some states are talking about they need thousands and thousands of workers that help the local health departments do all this casework. Do you know how many people will be on hand to do the contact tracing for Indiana?
Yes, sir. We're going to start with 500 individuals that we will actually be training. The American State and Territorial Health Officers have actually put together a 3-hour to 4-hour video training for contact tracing and how to do that good history. And that will be overseen by our epidemiologist. The workforce that you're talking about is going to come in very handy, because if you think about it, if we're calling a person, we've texted them and said, you need to call us, and now we're giving them information that they're positive, they're probably going to have a lot of questions about, wow, what does this mean to me? You know, we want to be able to say that 80% of people do well and don't have any serious complications, but these are the things you need to watch for. So we are engaging individuals that are oftentimes retired and can't work on the front lines because we're worried about their underlying chronic conditions or their age, but they will be great to be associated with us and actually taking some of these medical calls and supporting that. So it's going to be a combined work, and we may very well need to add even more to our call center as we go forward. But remember, we still have all that workforce in our local health departments to complement what we're doing.
Yeah, and John, I would just say that 500, that initial investment, that army, there's a lot of wisdom in our retired medical professionals. And you talked about the 12,000 that signed up in a quickness. And there's also a lot of wisdom in our medical students. And so it's kind of like putting a 4-star general back on the battlefield. We feel very good and confident about how we're standing up on this mission.
Ted Lynn, Wayne TV.
Good afternoon, Ted.
Good afternoon, Governor, and thank you for doing this.
Sure.
And Dr. Box, my wife and I will pray for your father tonight. I hope he gets better.
Thank you.
But Governor, the day after tomorrow is May the 1st, and we're all on the edge of our seats to hear what you have to say. But of course, that's all also May, isn't it? It's the glorious time of the year in Indianapolis, usually. So this may seem a little frivolous and self-serving, but it's not. It's real life. I have attended 36 Indianapolis 500s in a row, and 40 total. That pales to the attendance numbers of many, many Indianapolis 500 race fans. Mr. Penske's race has been rescheduled for less than 4 months from now. Yeah. With threats to gatherings of any size, do you honestly believe that the largest single day spectator sporting event in the world will happen with stands full of people and without face masks on August the 23rd?
It very well could, Ted. And I hope it does. And a lot of what we're doing right now is going to determine that. And so that's why, and I'm not going to release the timeline today nor tomorrow, by the way, when I'm connected online to this press conference. But if we continue on the path that we're on, that race could continue. I was born in or raised in Claremont, Indiana, so that was the IMS was in my backyard, so to speak, and could hear the cars running. And we used to take the race in on the radio in the garage before I started to go. So this is near and dear to my heart. I haven't missed too many races as of late, but that's what we're working toward. And there's a lot of other memories that families have been making on an annual basis outside of racing and outside of sports. And so the days that that we want to get back to, that's why we're making all these investments. That's why we're asking people to sacrifice so much at the outset so that we can get on the right course and stay on the right course. And we'll, the progress that we make, we'll manage this very methodically because again, to your point, Ted, and it's a very good point, you might want to elaborate on this, Dr. Box. I kind of touched on it yesterday, but look, let's not be delusional about this. We're going to have positive cases month after month after month after month after month. I just believe. It's how we manage our way through this. It's how we have the ability to care for those folks who are in need. So yes, we look at the positive cases, but the most important thing is where do those positive cases go next? What's the next step? Are they going to an ICU bed? Are they isolated? How are they being cared for? And that's what's most important. So we're gonna be able to get back to a new normal at some point. We're there in some respects right now. We're in the second quarter in my mind. Probably coming out of the locker room at halftime come Friday. But Ted, that's the goal, is to get to a August race. By the way, if you're in the NASCAR, they've got a July race, and there's a lot of picnics on that Independence Day weekend. So our goal is to get there, but we're going to get there responsibly.
Brandon Smith, Indiana Public Broadcasting.
Afternoon, Brandon.
Afternoon, Governor. I want to ask more about contact tracing. Just so first, Dr. Box, so I can clarify. So initial contact tracing will happen entirely through the call center for every positive COVID case. How will local health departments be used as a backup? What sort of situations would require that?
So the important thing to know is that those positive tests through our data system at the State Department of Health will still be accessible to and available to and get and go to each of our local health departments at the same time as we are acting on them at the State Department of Health. And we have a software Microsoft platform that will actually allow us to, as I said, we get that positive contact text or email that individual. If we do not hear back from them within 4 hours, we will be calling that individual. And then as we do that history and we put all that into the Microsoft platform, once again, our local health departments have access to all that. And they can act on that. They can even get in and add updates to that as they need to and want to. That system will be able to ping them about, wow, this is a person who works in a long-term care facility, or, you know, this is an individual who works at a meatpacking plant. So those are the things that I'm hoping our local health departments can really take to heart, look at, and then act on. Right? And then be there as that local resource for individuals that are now isolating and quarantining. So we're going away from those things that we do to a broader population, like those big policies that the governor has put in place, to now those policies that are directed at individuals who are contacts of or positive cases associated with COVID-19.
Ryan O'Leary, The Daily Journal.
Hello, Ryan.
How are you today?
Doing good, thank you. How about yourself?
I'm doing all right. I have a pair of questions. I think the first one may be for Dr. Box and the second one would be for you.
Okay.
The first would be gyms and fitness centers were among the first businesses to reopen in the state of Georgia last week. How far is Indiana from allowing those gyms to open back up? And what regulations and precautions does the state plan to put in place to ensure that it would be safe to go back into those spaces?
The second question
would be, the governor of Iowa has said that any employee who refuses to go back to work once business is reopened would be considered a voluntary quit and thus ineligible to collect unemployment. What is Indiana's stance on that matter? And if you agree with Governor Reynolds, how do you square it with the OSHA General Duty Clause that requires employers to furnish a workplace free from recognized hazards?
So I'll start out with the first question and give the easy one to the governor. realistically, this was a big discussion this past weekend. Those of us who like to exercise, and that is a good stress reliever and a good mental health support for us, really believe in this. I will say that gyms are a classic place for people to get infected. We're all working out. We're running on treadmills next to each other. We're using the same equipment. You know, there are things there to wipe the equipment down, but we don't always do that. Sometimes we're up brushing our face
face or wiping the sweat out of our eyes or whatever. So those are ways that we can get infected. So all of that will have to be addressed. And I know that gyms will do that, but the social distancing will be absolutely something that we have to do, or barriers between treadmills, the ability to wipe every machine down, and then to limit the number of individuals that are in the gym at the same time, including things like spin classes and you know, whatever class that you tend to do.
Yeah, I would say, and Commissioner Fred Payne's at the podium here, but I would say, look, Kim Reynolds is a buddy of mine. She's a great governor. She, as well as 48 other governors and myself, are all thinking about the same thing, and that is, you know, so many of us went into this time period. We had in the state of Indiana, Fred, you can correct me if I'm off course here, but we had about 90,000 unfilled, high-wage, high-demand jobs when we went into this storm. And everything changed, for sure, over the last couple months. And Fred, you can give us the latest 350 to 400,000 number. So that, but we're all thinking about on the other side of this, and we all understand that many of the jobs, some won't be there. We'll just be realistic about this. And then there will be different jobs available. Our job is to make sure that we're getting you to a better job when you go back, to your job or a better job, because they're going to be jobs. And everything that we do in terms of our workforce development programs, our training programs that have been very successful, other governors are trying to steal this idea around the country. We'll get back at that. We know from the Secretary of Commerce, Jim Schellinger, who's been in constant contact with companies all over the world, all over the country, all over the state of Indiana, that there are plans to not just reemerge, but to grow again safely. And so our trick is going to be, and that's probably, having not seen what she exactly said, that's probably what she's thinking about as well. We have a situation here in the state of Indiana where folks, you know, when they're offered their job back, when it's safe to go back to work, and Fred, you might just kind of go into the details about what he's getting at, which legislatively we're compelled to follow.
Sure. I think your question is a good one, and it's one of the questions that many employers are asking us about. And we have put in place a few webinars where we will be informing employers a little bit more on this issue, and we will also have webinars where we will inform individuals who will be going back to work on this. But what we have been specifically focused on is ensuring that individuals are getting the benefits right now. Once individuals are asked to return to work, legislatively, they are required to return to work. Based upon the CARES Act, some of the benefits that are laid out under the CARES Act, those benefits are available when an employee is unable to work due to COVID-19 and due to that employer not having available work for them. So we will be providing a little bit more guidance on this. What's required under federal law, and then also what's required generally under unemployment law. I can't get into a whole lot of details because I'll probably take up too much of the time here, but this is really a big topic of concern for both employers and employees, and we want to make sure that we get on the right foot on this. And as the governor mentioned, in terms of coming out of this, when it comes to the number of jobs and the opportunities that would be available, prior to going into COVID-19, we had pretty much the highest rate of individuals who were on training programs that we had provided in the state's history. We don't see that slowing down once we get out of COVID-19. We already have in place sort of rapid response plans to make sure that we get out of this pretty quickly, to skill people up, to make sure people get a job, a better job, and into a career. So thanks for asking the question, and we are looking at this.
And Fred, you might just add that you're going to be here tomorrow. You might just add some more flavor to that answer.
Sure.
Whitney Downard, CNHI.
Good afternoon, Whitney.
Good afternoon, Governor. I've got a kind of multi-pronged question here. I wanted to know if there was a staffing commitment attached to that Maximus contract, and if so, how many they are committed to, and if that is enough contact tracers what kind of training they would be getting, or can just anybody do contact tracing? And then I did want to know if we had more information on how Maximus was selected for this contract.
All good questions. So, as I said, right now, the staffing contract is for 500 individuals, and those individuals do not have to have a college degree, but we are looking for individuals that can complete an online training course. As I mentioned, the American State and Territorial Health Officers actually came up with a contact tracing and an original investigation platform for us to help train. Our EPIs, our epidemiologists at the State Department of Health, will actually be actively engaged with them in training and working with them on site to make sure that they have the support that they need, and then we'll have additional medical support for them. Maximus was chosen by the fact, again, just like our testing, we wanted to stand this up very, very quickly. So what we did was we went to seven different companies that the state already has good rapport and relationship with, and that we've known have had a good track record with the state, and we told them that we needed to stand this up quickly and that we needed to know how they would stand it up and what the cost of that would be. And then we had a large group of individuals from multi-agencies here at the state level that actually looked at each of those proposals and decided that Maximus gave the best quality for the best price.
And we didn't have 45 days to wait.
No, we didn't.
Rob Burgess, the Wabash Plain Dealer.
Good afternoon, Rob.
Good afternoon, Governor. Dr. Box, I wish your father better health. I wanted to return to May 1st, Governor Holcomb. If I'm a small business owner, it's not as if just because I'm allowed to reopen, my customers will necessarily feel comfortable patronizing my establishment again immediately.
Yep.
It doesn't the state loosening these restrictions remove the leverage I may now have with my creditors and landlords?
No, I don't think so. And by the way, if you're not ready to open, don't. We're saying you can open when we get to that day for these specific businesses, just exactly how we have in the past with elective medical procedures, et cetera. And so our goal is to, when folks can open, it's how they open, again, safely. We'd like to see, we're not telling anyone to open prematurely.
Sherry with the Indianapolis Star.
Hello, Sherry. Good afternoon.
Hello. Good afternoon. Thank you. This question is for, well, I guess for either one of you. I have two questions about contact tracing. One is, it's not ASTHO, but the National Association of County and City Health Officials has recommended 30 contact tracers per 100,000 people, which I calculated would bring us to about 2,000. About four times as many as what Maximus is hiring. So I wondered if you could talk about the discrepancy between those two numbers. And also I wondered if you could clarify a bit, early on in the pandemic, there were a lot of individuals who felt that they had contact with people who came back positive and were never told, were never contacted by the contact tracers. So who actually qualifies as a quote unquote close contact who should be contacted?
So that takes a lot of time, and that's what initial interview takes a couple of hours to do a lot of times, is to discuss where were those settings. Obviously, anybody that you're living with in your home is a close contact, and those individuals, if they're symptomatic, need to be tested. If they have an essential job, we would test them and, you know, let them go back to their work, provided they're negative, but they need to be isolated and hopefully quarantined at home while their loved one is getting better. When we look at numbers, I think, Sherry, that's a really good question. So we didn't want to overhire to begin with. You have to understand we have lots of epidemiologists at the State Department of Health. We do have a lot of students from our public health schools here in the state that are engaged with us. And then we have our entire workforce at our local health departments that are taking a part of this on. So as we start out, we believe that this is the number we need. But if we need more, we will definitely be getting more.
Greg with the South Bend Tribune.
Good afternoon, Greg.
Good afternoon, Governor. Families are telling us here they're still not getting information about from this the state announced on Monday about requiring long-term care facilities to provide residents and their their designated families. Now, we also learned that the state may have privately told nursing homes they don't have to implement the communications requirements until next week. If that's the case, how come it wasn't explained like Monday's announcement that the new rules might not go into effect? And what do you say to families that are still having trouble getting their information on the number of positive tests and deaths in those nursing homes?
Yeah, Dr. Dan has beamed himself over to the podium magically, so you want to...
Yeah. Thanks so much for the question. A couple things. One is, when we came out with the communication guidance on Monday, there were really two parts of that. One is the expectation that long-term care facilities continue what they already have been asked to do, which is to communicate changes in their COVID status. The thing that was really new with that was the daily requirement part of that. So we did that on Monday, and we recognize that for some long-term care facilities to be able to make that communication daily may take a little bit of time and may take a little bit of technological working. So as part of that, we will implement the daily reporting requirement on Monday. I don't think there was a reason specific. We didn't hold that back specifically. It was more about, once we put the guidance out, making sure that they had the appropriate time to put that in place. If family members are not being communicated, and keep in mind this is for the representative of that resident, then they should reach out to us at Family Outreach at isdh.indiana.gov. That's a site where we will be able to take all of those specific complaints. We will be able to investigate those and engage the regional ombudsman if needed to intervene.
Nikki Kelly, the Fort Wayne Journal Gazette.
Good afternoon, Nikki.
Good afternoon. I wanted to talk to you about hospitalization, ventilator, ICU numbers are coming down, which is your decision making. But people are pointing out to me they're concerned, why the time to lit up on the restrictions? If won't that cause just another spike again, and then the numbers will go back up?
We are not using just ventilators and ICU beds. We're also looking at numbers of admissions to the hospital and actually EMS runs. So we're using a large part of our data to look at this. And as we've looked at all of that across the state, every single preparedness or healthcare region in the state is going down except one, and that is our region 4, where we have the Tyson plant outbreak. So there's an understanding about that. It's hard. I know a lot of people want to use the number of cases, but all states are ramping up the amount of testing that they're doing, so the number of cases continues to go up, and that's what we want to see, because that means we're testing more people. What I would like to see is eventually that percentage of cases that is positive going down, meaning that instead of 18% to 19% of those cases coming back positive, we start to see that drop down into the 15%, 13%, 12%. Not only does that mean we're testing more people, probably more asymptomatic people that are contacts or involved with some of our congregate living or other areas, but also meaning that we're just having fewer people infected.
Yeah, and I would just add, Nikki, that it's actually the two questions also to add to put into that equation is, who are using these resources and how are they acting? So we know that about 91% of our Indiana deaths, unfortunately, are 60 years or older. And it gets, you know, more exaggerated at 70 to 79 and 80 on up. And so how is that cohort acting? So when we say lifting or opening up, that's just not a blanket statement. It has to do with who and how they are acting and how what is being opened is safely conducting business in this new world.
That's an important caveat with everything that we talk about, is that those at-risk populations.
That's right.
I'm still not excited about you going to the Indianapolis 500 or to the big gathering. That's really important that you continue to protect ourselves. I mean, ultimately, knowing that you either have antibody that indicates you may have immunity and or have received the vaccine is going to be the real protection that we're looking for.
Yeah, just to be blunt, I mean, if you're 65 and older with underlying health conditions, you're going to be living in a new normal for a while, and how we react to that is in large part up to us, and we're going to do everything that we can to help. But we got to deal with reality here. So it's not just one size fits all, or we're going to open up every business and go right back to the way it was. That won't be included on May 1st.
Eric Berman, WIBC.
Good afternoon, Eric.
Good afternoon, Governor. Dr. Box, Health Bureau, Fiber recovers quickly. I wanted to go back to last week. Dr. Doss said last week that she was going to be talking with her counterpart in Ohio about the mass testing of inmates. 2 days ago, she said in this setting that we were not going to do that, that we didn't have the resources. My question is, what was Ohio able to do that we're not able to replicate? And does the deal with Optum taking some of the pressure off the health department, does that change that formula at all?
Thank you. Kristen Doss, Chief Medical Officer for Indiana Department of Correction. We did talk to Ohio and their health authority for their correctional facilities. And one of the lessons that they learned was from doing mass testing, right? And some of the things that they mentioned to us is, as we've heard here, is it's a snapshot in time. So some of the rates that you may see elsewhere, the rates were just higher in congregate settings. We already know that. We hear that here every single day. So the approach that we've taken here is we are going to test people. Just today, I requested strike teams back out to test certain folks. So we are going to continue testing. Our numbers are going to continue going up because we are going to test more. However, at the same time, we want to be targeted in how we test. We want to move quickly. We want to isolate and we want to quarantine folks if they have symptoms, period. And really, the test is additional information for who may be in that dorm or that unit or that setting. But what we've learned from not just Ohio, but other surrounding states is the test is just one piece of it, but it's not the whole package to ensuring that folks have comprehensive treatment. Thanks.
Demetrios, WTWO.
Good afternoon, Demetrios.
Good afternoon, Governor. I had a question about the way that COVID-19 deaths are reported. I was wondering if a person had tested positive and then had since recovered and then were to die from something unrelated, such as a car accident or something of that sort, would the state count that as a COVID-19 death?
No, that we would not count that as a COVID-19 death. Not unless he had a pulmonary embolus through a blood clot because of his COVID-19 infection or something, but that would not be counted.
Adam Van Oostel, Legislative Insight.
Good afternoon, Adam.
Good afternoon, Governor. I wanted to ask about contact tracing. What steps are being taken related to privacy protections? And is participation in this voluntary? Are people going to have to download an app? Are people's locations going to be tracked? Thank you.
Yep.
Very, very good questions. All of the things that we looked at, actually, this concept that we could track your cell phone and know where you are and knew who you were in contact with and then reach out to them, it didn't seem like something that was going to be very comfortable for a lot of people, and I wasn't really comfortable about the privacy of that. This, however, is something that, from a public health standpoint, you really are obligated to answer us and to give us a call back. But all of this is still private health information, and it's not something that we share widely. We do share it with local health departments and the individuals that will be actually doing the contact tracing. And you really are obligated to give us information about your contacts. And you want to do that because we don't want them to get sick or to go home and make someone who may be at risk in their home sick. So it is really, really important so that individuals have the heads up and can protect the people that they love and live with.
Yeah, and I would just, and as I understand it, these tracers will never ask for your social security number or for money or for financial information. Mm-hmm. So it's mindful of all those things.
Our final question is from Michael Gallenberger, WKVI.
Hello, Michael. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Governor. I'm looking for some clarification on your executive order closing school facilities until the end of the school year. Based on some clarification given by Dr. McCormick yesterday, many schools now believe their facilities have to be closed to the public through June 30th. That would mean they shouldn't be planning to hold activities like sports practices, possibly graduation, until July. Was that indeed your intention? And if so, is that June 30th date set in stone? or is that one of the things that could be eased in the next couple of rounds of executive orders if conditions allow?
We will elaborate a bit on this come Friday, May 1st, but schools are, the public buildings are shut down for instructional purposes, but we will address this come Friday at 2:30.
Thank you for joining Governor Holcomb's briefing. Governor Holcomb's next briefing